are issues of corruption, allegations of corruption against the person and the office of the Inspector General of Police, brought through a motion by Honorable Prestige, OC, and the matter was referred to this ad hoc committee. Issues of threat to the life of DCP Abduyari Lafia. And from the time this petition came before this committee, copies of the petition was made available to all relevant offices, including the Office of the Inspector General, who was allegedly and directly accused, and the Office of the Police Service Commission. In our first sitting, the IG's office was represented by a 7 Commissioner of Police, legal, who came with a letter saying that the IG was on official assignment, and we obliged and took him. And they have also responded to all the issues raised by Yari. However, they went further in their submission to let this committee know that the issues before this committee are the same issues before competent courts of law. And therefore, whatever we are doing here will be sub judice. But to be fair to their submission, they went ahead to say, the IG went ahead to say he will leave that to the discretion of the committee. In our second sitting, the IG was not there, and there was no letter of authority for anybody to represent him. But because of the institution of the police, we still allowed the Commissioner of Police, who was there, to sit on his behalf. And the same issues were canvassed. It was at that point the committee felt it was necessary for us to adjourn and then look at the issues before the court of law and the issues that are brought to the House. We gave a long adjournment for about 2 weeks now, and also with the thinking that the time will be enough for the parties to even look for some form of settlement, so that we will not be washing our dirty linens before the Nigerian public and the international community. However, up till today, that seems not to have happened, and we give a new date for sitting. Today we are here. Honorable colleagues, I'd like to inform you that just as we were about coming to this sitting, I received another missive from the IG, which the office has photocopied and then distributed to honorable members. It is based on that that I will, after I finish, maybe we take the submission of the Police Service Commission, the chairman, who is personally here with us today. And after we take his submissions, members will now look at the new missive from the IG. Thank you.
The suspension predated the court order. In fact, he went to court because of the suspension. That was where the order came after the suspension had taken place. Political in the office, the date of suspension, the date went to court, didn't go to court order. The 3 days and the file in the office. I'll continue to you later on if you need it.
What I said the last time we were here, I said that I went to court when I got wind of the fact that the IG was planning and is planning to write a recommendation to the Police Service Commission for my suspension. And I caused my lawyer to write the IG to inform him that the matter is already in court. So despite receiving those processes, the IG went ahead and recommended for my suspension to the Police Service Commission. Consequent upon that, the Police Service Commission suspended me without giving me any opportunity to defend myself. So can I continue, Sam? Yes. So it was on the weight of that that we approached the court and informed the court that despite the fact that the matter is before the court, the IG went ahead and recommended and Police Service Commission acted upon. Then the court now issued an order asking them not to take any further steps because he was planning to even follow it up with a dismissal. Thank you very much, sir.
Document so that we're not just talking orally. We need to see the copy of the court process itself, including all the court orders. We need to see the letter of suspension so that we are very sure of which dates will guide these proceedings. Mr. Chairman, that is my submission. So that we are not just assuming, because we have two diametrically opposed views now. The chairman has said the action was taken before the order of court. He is saying he treated the matter in court before action was taken by the police. These are very, very grave allegations, and we need to get to the bottom of it. And we don't want to assume, because we're a law-abiding institution also.
Thank you so much, sir. I think the documentation,
he didn't put the Police Service Commission on notice about the fact that he was going to be suspended. He said when he got wind of the move to suspend him, he wrote to the IG, he got his lawyer to write to the IG to stop it, or else he will go to court. He didn't say he wrote to the Police Service Commission. So all his interactions were with the IG. And the suspension by the Police Service Commission was predicated on the recommendation of the IG. And the commission had no knowledge of whatever happened between the petitioner and the IG before his recommendation to us came. So it was after the suspension that the petitioner now went to court. A violation of any court rule will be not by the Police Service Commission, because we had no prior knowledge of whatever happened. Thank you, sir.
You just get a letter from the IG and suspend that person without even inviting the person to hear from the person. I just want to know the processes of doing it, especially when it's a senior police officer.
That are already on. But I think that beyond that, you need to do a submission. You need to do a submission to this committee on all you know about the issue, particularly what your legal is explaining. They cannot just be verbal explanations. You put it down in writing to this committee of all you know, and then the committee will look at it. The issues that are sub judice, we will so look at them. And the ones that we can actually take, like my colleague Edward said, we cannot be doing verbal talking here. We have to look at the dates of what the man who brought the petition, through which a motion came, what he's claiming that he did, and what you are doing, and what you have done already, so that we can now follow up with questions like the questions my colleague Zodo is asking. Is that the wish of the committee?
Yes. By the Police Service Commission, it's one of the mandates of the Police Service Commission as it shown in the Act. And the process is this. If an officer is indicted or suspected of being guilty of misconduct, he issued a query. He answered the query is processed. If the founder that he has explanation to offer is invited before the for disciplinary committee, the for disciplinary committee still over his matter, they recommend to IG. If the matter that is beyond IG, they now send to Prison Rights Commission. A recommendation from IG. The Prison Rights Commission will now award the punishment or do whatever we want to do. If the matter that is criminal in nature, the officer is investigated. An investigation is issued a query. The query goes to the whole hog of for the party committee, which I started when I was IG. My friend officer should have a say. Before it's a query, the person is processed and is punished. I said, well, an officer should be listened to. So he should appear before the party committee. The party committee is the DIGA is the chairman, all the DIGs are there. The first secretary is. So they listen to the officers, ask the questions, they recommend to IG. So if the display phase is a criminal matter, they do that. And sometimes the officer may be under investigation or detention. And maybe to be charged to court. They suspend you first of all, the right for suspension. The Prison Rights Commission suspends him because he cannot be charged to court as a service member taking any salary. So he suspended. The police now do what they want to do. They charge you to court or the investigation. He goes to court, same suspension. If at the end of the day you win the case in court, he comes back, he's reinstated. That's how it happens, suspension. Before the IG recommended him for suspension, he must have gone through all this process. He now called the Prison Rights Commission. We now come to suspension. We approve it for the IG. Then they put him. Sometimes, as the IG said, the officer may be in detention in the police cell or whatever. So the commission approves. Right to IG, your committee has been approved. He knows what to do there.
Being processed by the Department of Police Discipline for presentation to the Commission by plenary through the Standing Committee on Pending Disciplinary Matters, we received an official notification, service of process, court summons, we put it in bracket, in the legal proceedings filed by the National Industrial Corp of Nigeria in the Abuja Judicial Division, suit number NICN ABJ 361-2007, by DCP Abdul Yari S. Lafia, relating to all the issues fundamentally raised in the pending disciplinary matters processed by the police authority to the commission for a decision on the said officer. The commission is a party to the suit as a second defendant. Therefore, the matter has become sub judice. In the light of the above and your letter under reference, the commission stood down the matter pending the determination of the suit by the court. Accept assurances of the commission's high regards. M.F. Estipanos, Permanent Secretary to the Commission. In the light of what I've read, are you still saying that you forwarded the court summons to us? Because that's the question that I asked. Because this letter is saying you're only referring to the summons, you didn't attach, otherwise, you are an experienced officer, you rose to the rank of an IG. There's no way here this letter says it's an attached court order. You're only just making, that's how we say it, we don't want to assume. I asked the chairman for permission that we want to see an actual court order, because an order of court will not only have the signature of the judge, it will also have the stamp and seal of the court, so that we read and then it's addressed categorically and specifically to the House of Representatives or to this committee, then we know what to do. But if you just write to us and say you are referring to an order, how do we know whether that order exists
or not. So if it is this letter, you will agree with us. And if you want, I give it back to you again. Show us where there's a court summons attached to this letter.
How long does it take you to dispense such cases? Or is it that every recommendation from the IG that your own is to execute order of the IG? If the IG recommends whatever, you just carry it out, or you have your own theory where you will look into the matter and take, you know, a decision? If yes, what is the normal period that it takes? And also, how long did you receive the IG's letter? And then how long did it take you to, you know, recommend or to approve the suspension?
I think that all the necessary papers of both the processing of the transmission of IG's office to the commission need to be tendered to this committee, as well as the court proceedings. But our revered chairman of commission, I know that the responsibility of promotion and discipline lies with the commission, particularly of senior officers of the police force. If that is the case, and as it is, the expectation is that for you to carry out an Inspector General's recommendation will still be based on your investigation of the facts which the Inspector General or his committee relied upon, particularly in a situation where the Inspector General is the person in issue. If a subordinate is petitioning his boss, you know that becomes a very sensitive issue, because you are likely to have fair attention. You are also likely to be served a miscarriage of justice. And so you, as chairman, former IG, very experienced leader in the police force and in the commission, expects to, you know, bring into bear all the provisions in the law that will make you feel that you are serving justice to an officer who is in disagreement with, or who has raised issues against his boss. My desire is, if you can really, truly let us through, that you carry it out based on the Inspector General's recommendation to your office, the appropriate instruments of the law giving you powers for promotion and discipline were thoroughly put into play. The law was thoroughly, you know, the procedure was thoroughly followed through in serving a suspension. Yes, I agree that sometimes, for purposes of investigation, suspensions are also used to keep the person out of office. But because you are a very experienced man, and we all respect you, and you know the police force and the law, we like to get convinced that your commission gave the appropriate follow-through of the procedure in serving justice.
It was granted when the IG recommended to us, and the officer had been investigated and needed to be out of office for reason to take place appropriately, or is in detention. We don't want to be in detention. detention for too long, or is to be charged to court. In quick, he can be charged to court as a police officer. He should be charged to court when suspended. This suspension, when it comes to us, it takes priority because the commission finished this very matter, has this very matter that needs to be dismissal, reduction in rank, whatever punishment. When the PTA comes to us, the commissioner, the producer, the IG says details are by officer. We have a standing committee. Standing committee will sit, look at the matter, and they bring it to plenary. The plenary meets 4 times a year. So we cannot wait suspension to go to plenary because there's no time for it. There's no time for suspension because suspension, and that the officer has been detained, or they're going to investigate him, or to be charged to court. So for suspension, the suspension doesn't go to plenary. Suspension comes, I look at the facts, the suspended officer, can help the IG do what you want to do. The rest, other people will go to plenary, go to standing committee. It will take a long time. So that will be part of the question asked. How long does the case take? It takes a long time, depending on the matter. Because plenary meets only 4 times a year. So the officers who have the plenary committee look at this matter, go to the file, look at call for officers file to the standing committee look at it, then the plenary will meet to take a decision. So for suspension, so they don't go through that. But other matters go through the committee
before the court. And beginning to elaborate and explain them here now, like the tasking us, you understand? So in our submission to this committee, we'll try as much as possible to be as explicit as everybody will understand the issues involved. Thank you very much. The
matter is sub judice, and therefore, the matter before Parliament should not continue. And I think that is the thing we want to determine today. Honorable colleagues, before we go into that, my ruling on the questions from my colleagues and the response from the chairman of the Police Service Commission is that the letters or the letter of suspension which was written to the commission by the IG on DCP Lafia should also be attached in your submissions. And every other relevant letter, your own suspension letter, and all other relevant letters should be attached to your submission to this committee, and all documents in connection with this matter. Well, you are still very relevant to this investigation, very, very relevant. So maybe in subsequent meetings, if you are not so chanced as the chairman, you can send your legal representative, who will oblige. But if you are chanced, we'll advise that you come. And thank you, sir. We just received this letter this afternoon from the IG. And it's a 9-page letter. Earlier before now, the IG wrote, still telling us that this matter is sub judice. But even at that, because of the respect he has for the legislature, he went ahead to explain his own side. And thereafter, in his conclusion, he still said it's subject to our own discretion. But today, I've received another letter, first of all informing this committee that he has urgent national security matters to attend to, which is very okay. But towards the closing of the letter, he now made his own conclusions that this committee has no right because the matters are in court and it is sub judice. Honorable colleagues,
I would like to give this letter to Barrister Don Kuo of the Legal Department of the House of Representatives to read aloud to everybody's hearing. Because the letter just came, we have not been able to synthesize it. Few of us have read it. I'm sure some others have not even read it. So that after hearing, let us take for once a decision on whether what the IG has pleaded and what the Police Service Commission, the letter they have written to us, if they are in order, whether we should stop this investigative hearing or written by the Inspector General of Police on the directive of the Commissioner of Police, on the directive given to the Commissioner of Police, Legal Prosecution Section, First Criminal Intelligence and Investigation Department, Nigerian Police Force, Kafaru Tinubu, Force Headquarters, Abuja. It's a letter addressed to the chairman of this honorable committee, dated 27th March 2018, captioned, need to investigate the allegations of unwarranted harassment, persecution, and threat to life by DCP Abdulyari Eslafia against the Inspector General of Police. And it goes thus. I have been directed by the Inspector General of Police to refer to your letter dated 21st March 2018, inviting him to yet another hearing on the above subject matter, and to inform you that the Inspector General of Police will not be able to honor the invitation due to very important national security assignment. Paragraph 2. It could be recalled that on the 13th of February 2018, you transmitted the letter of complaint made by DCP Abdulyari Eslafia against the Inspector General of Police and called for his response. The Inspector General responded to all the allegations in a letter addressed to the Honorable Speaker of the House of Representatives and attention you. A copy of the letter is attached. Paragraph 3. The Inspector General of Police, in his response, reiterated that his response to the committee was out of respect for the House, considering the fact that DCP Abdulyari Eslafia had instituted 3 suits in court. The fact of the case in court, which are still subsisting, and the allegations in his petition are the same and therefore subjudice. Under the rules of the House, specifically Order 905, the committee ought not to make reference to the matter since the decision of the court on the matter is being awaited. Paragraph 4. Despite the above, the committee went ahead to invite the Inspector General of Police to a hearing. But because of the security summit which held in Kaduna on the same date, the Inspector General of Police was unable to attend, but sent the Commissioner of Police Legal Section and DCP, Inspector General of Police Monitoring Unit, to represent him. Paragraph 5. The Inspector General of Police representative at the hearing further reiterated that the matter before the committee was subjudice based on the 3 suits pending in court. The committee at this point requested the police and the petitioner to make copies of the 3 suits available to them to guide their decision on whether the matter is subjudice or not. The 3 suits were consequently forwarded to the chairman of the committee on the 5th of March 2018 by the Commissioner of Police Legal. Copies of the suit are once more attached. Paragraph 6. For the avoidance of doubts and to re-emphasize the fact that the facts of the matter have been investigated by this committee and the 3 suits are the same, it is appropriate to call the committee attention to the affidavit in support of the originating summon in suit number NICN/ABJ/316/2017 between DCP Abdulyari Eslafia and Inspector General of Police. The statement of claim in suit number NICN/ABJ/361/2017 between DCP Abdulyari Eslafia and Inspector General of Police and the Chairman Police Service Commission, as well as a petition before the committee. Paragraph 7. A community reading of this document
will clearly show that the facts of the allegations of corruption contained in the petition before the House are the same with the matters before the court. I refer the committee to paragraph 4 of the affidavits in support of suit number NICN/ABJ/316/2017 and paragraphs 17 and 21 of the statement of claim in suit number NICN/ABJ/361/2017, paragraph 8. In any case, allegation of corruption is criminal in nature, and the simple maxim of law is that he who alleges must prove his case beyond reasonable doubt. It is after the person making the allegation has succeeded in proving his allegation by the production of evidence which must be analyzed, processed, and found to be true that the accused can be invited to respond to the evidence which has been produced against him. The practice of intimidation and harassment of accused persons without first and foremost ensuring that the accuser has produced sufficient evidence to prove his case is against international best practice and must be discouraged and resisted. Paragraph 9. It is expected that the committee should ask DCP Abdulyari Eslapia to produce evidence to show his refusal to be a conduit pipe, as alleged, has resulted to his current travail, or to produce persons whom he alleged offered bribe. It is after the committee has interviewed this person, alleged to have offered money, and the allegation found to be accurate, that the Inspector General of Police can be in fact invited, preferably by the anti-corruption agencies. Paragraph 10. The legislature derives their oversight function from Section 88 of the Constitution, and the purpose of that function is captured in Section 88 of Section 2, which states that powers conferred on the National Assembly under provisions of Section 88 are exercisable only for the purpose of enabling it to A, make laws with respect to any matter within its legislative competence and correct any defects in existing legislation, and B, expose corruption, inefficiency, or waste in the execution of administration of laws within its legislative competence and in the disbursement of all administration by it. Paragraph 11. The Inspector General of Police has nothing to hide. I can say with all amount of certainty that the allegation by DCP Abiyari is baseless and an attempt to derail the already acclaimed good job being done by the Inspector General of Police in the areas of crime fighting and welfare for police officers. In any case, if the DCP is able to produce evidence to substantiate his allegations, the House of Representatives is obligated under their power in Section 88(2), subsection 2B, to forward the evidence to any law enforcement agencies for investigation. Paragraph 12. The committee has in one of its sittings stated, and correlated to, that an Inspector General of Police was once arrested, prosecuted, and convicted. The Inspector General of Police that was prosecuted and convicted was not first dragged before the National Assembly to face his accuser before the press, as criminal investigation is not conducted in such manner. Criminal allegations are investigated by the law enforcement agencies, and anybody found to have committed an offense is charged before the court for trial. Paragraph 13. This is the beauty of democracy and the principle of separation of power provided for in our constitution. Under the principle, the legislature has the power to make laws as well as the oversight function captured in Section 88. The purpose of such oversight has been stated earlier in this write-up. The executive arm has the responsibility to enforce the laws, while the judiciary as a third arm has the power to interpret the law. It is the duty of the judiciary to try persons found to have committed an offense under the law and to convict them. If the allegation is proven beyond reasonable doubt, according to prescribed punishment. Paragraph 14. The Inspector General of Police is prepared to meet DCP Abiyari in court and not at the committee room of the National Assembly, where the chairman of the committee has consistently made derogatory remarks against the IGP. The chairman of the committee openly berated the IGP for traveling on a leave approved by Mr. President without first and foremost finding out the reasons for such journey. This remark of the chairman was captured by the press and equally published both on the online and print media. This outburst of the chairman of the committee, to say the least, is an indication of biases towards the person of the IGP. Paragraph 15. In conclusion, it is the conviction of the IGP that the matter before the committee is the same with the three suits filed in court by DCP Abijaru, and will not make any further comment on the issue, as that will be subject to this. You are therefore requested to respect Order 905 of the House rules and avoid making reference to the matter. If, however, the House feels otherwise, the position of the IGP on the matter, as presented in his response already forwarded to you, is sacrosanct. Copy of the IGP representation is attached. Please accept the warm regards of State General Police. Signed by CP David Igbodo, Commissioner of Police, Legal, for Inspector General Police. Thank you.
First, this issue of this matter being sub judice. If it is sub judice, we have learned people here, we have legal department in the House of Representatives. He has quoted our own rules. He's coming into our bedroom to quote our own rules. So we will interpret those rules, why those rules are there. The Constitution is there. So I will now leave the floor open to my colleagues. You have all heard, even though you have not read it before. And for those who have read it, let us take.
Let me in addition say that the allegations are against the Inspector General of Police, not any other officer. And so I'm as well surprised that someone seemed to say he's directed and is copying the person in issue, which means this lecture may not be the position of the man in issue. If it were, then he didn't need to say he's directed. He only needed to sign for the Inspector General of Police. And so I'm very surprised at this. In my years of civil service, before I came into politics, I'm shocked at this. Chairman, the other point is, I want to refer the committee to Order 9 that was quoted in this letter. And he said, Order 9, specifically Rule 5. And Mr. Chairman, I beg your permission to read it out. Order 9, Rules of Debate, Rule 1, Sub 1, 5. Reference shall not be made to any matter on which a judicial decision is pending in such a way as might, in the speaker's opinion, prejudice the interests of parties thereto. By implication, the Inspector General is as well the Speaker of the House of Representatives, and his opinion is clearly spelled out in this lecture. I also want to, well, sometimes, like he disparaged the chairman of the committee and other members who made comments. It is not surprising when sometimes you watch on the television where the Inspector General himself is querying laws that are made by Parliament, trying to as well review laws, trying to say laws that are made by Parliament should not be implemented. He has himself become the judiciary in a number of instances, and I'm sure that Parliament is taking note of most of these things. I'm sure at the appropriate time, Parliament will rise to this occasion. Honorable Chairman, honorable colleagues, the writer of this lecture, who apparently is not the Inspector General of Police, also referred us to where he said, we can take evidence from the petitioner. If we are convinced about the evidences presented to this committee by the petitioner, then of course we are duty bound, based on our belief, to now invite him. That is my understanding in one breath. And so, if we listen to his evidence, if we collect his evidence in his absence, and feel very convinced, and then Inspector General, we are convinced about the petitioner's evidence, so you now come and state your case. Maybe, at that time, because he's not the author of this document, he's going to comply. But let us again go to this other contradiction. If you go to page 5 of this document, number 9, and maybe when you look at the last paragraph, that the Inspector General of Police can be invited preferably by the anti-corruption agencies. Are they courts of this nation, the anti-corruption agencies? Are they courts of this nation? If the parliament taking action, looking into this matter, will be subjudice. Is the anti-corruption agencies part of the judiciary, a court of competent jurisdiction to take over a matter from the court? I don't think so, and I see it as a contradiction of maybe a lecture that some of us would have taken into archives and used to live our lives tomorrow. Again, the Inspector General himself is finally saying that he will not appear because the matter is in court. Honorable Chairman, honorable colleagues, I don't think that in the first instance the committee is going to determine issues of criminality. A petitioner has a right to fair hearing by way of human rights. He took the commission to court to stop the commission from taking an action against him without fair hearing. And he has a right to that. That has nothing to do with the issues in substance. Because you must look for an interim way of seeking some reprieve before you are dealt with as if you don't have a right to defend yourself. And as Parliament, as representative of the people, if the Speaker, in his opinion, according to Order 9, Rule 5, has not given the prescription that the writer here, the lecturer, has prescribed, then it amounts to nothing. Because he cannot be the Speaker, and not even his boss can be the Speaker. It's only the Speaker that can decide so. And Parliament will listen to the presiding officer. Honorable colleagues, I see the writer of this epistle, of this lecture, as an affront on Parliament. However, I think that as people elected by our constituents, and those who are here and elected here to defend our people, I think that we have a right to look at the merits of how he feels that his human rights has been breached by not giving him a fair hearing. I think that these documents, Honorable Chairman, Honorable colleagues, amounts to no issue because the author is not in question here. The author is not in issue here. The person in issue here is the Inspector General of Police. And as far as I'm concerned, this document did not emanate from the Inspector General of Police. And so it should be so disregarded. That is my submission.
The former IG was served to Nigeria very, very well. So we're not disrespecting anybody.
including the present occupant of the office. We don't want you to misunderstand us as if we're in any combat. We're not in any combat. As a matter of fact, it's because of the rules of fair hearing, which have been alluded to here copiously by everyone, that we say, let us listen to him. Mr. Chairman, I start off by even the part of the letter where he read, where he said, the IG would have been more comfortable by us listening to the petitioner first, then if we deem it necessary, inviting him. Would that be in line with the rules of fair hearing? Because fair hearing demands that he should be here or represented, so that you will not say we are taking on somebody's evidence behind his back. That would not be fair hearing. It's better for, because in Nigeria, our legal system is adversarial. The meaning of that is that you now confront yourself, you hear what every other person is saying. And I don't want to repeat what Honorable Fred Abedi said, but you have listened to Order 9, Rule 5, which, from the clear wordings of that order, give Mr. Speaker the discretion to determine whether to proceed with the matter or not. Now, it is for the Speaker to now guide us in this committee whether, since, because I listened to you, it was said that the IG has written to the Speaker. He has not told us that the Speaker has determined, in line with this Order 9, Rule 5, that this matter is prejudicial. Because it is the Speaker that will interpret. This rule gives the Speaker the power of interpretation of whether the matter is prejudicial or not. So, all of us in Nigeria have taken judicial notice of the fact that it is Honorable, Right Honorable Yakubu Dogara that is the Speaker of the House of Representatives of Nigeria as of now. So, he's the one to tell us whether this is prejudicial or not. Again, on the issues the letter that you read, I don't want to be reading, I don't want to embarrass you by reading out all the contradictions. You yourself, you read Section 88, Subsection 2, and from what you read, it says, this National Assembly has the power to investigate corruption. Somebody has made an allegation of corruption, and this is the Constitution, which has given us the power. We are all bound by the Constitution. The Constitution has said we can investigate corruption. So how can the IG? In fact, I'm inclined to believe, Honorable Fred Abedi, that we don't believe that it's the IG that wrote that letter. And that's why we said it would be better for him to come, because he's the chief law enforcement agent in Nigeria. When it comes to law enforcement, he's the number one law enforcement officer in Nigeria. And this is the law. Whatever law anybody has, whether it is the Police Act, whether it's police regulations, any other regulations, whether it's the EFCC Act, ICPC Act, any other act, it is subordinate to this Constitution. And this Constitution has given us that power. Therefore, for that letter to purport to say that any criminal allegation ought to be referred to the investigating authorities, and you name them ICPC, EFCC, is forgetting the fact that those ones were created by us. It is this parliament that created the EFCC and the ICPC. What if tomorrow we decide to repeal those laws? We can very well not repeal them, but we are not going to repeal them. Before tomorrow, the media are supposed to say, we'll repeal them. No, but the Constitution, which is the ground norm, has given us the power to investigate. May I refer you to Section 89? I don't want to read it. Section 89 of the Constitution has even given us the power to summon any person in Nigeria. Thank God that you are nodding your head. Any person in Nigeria, I know that as a lawyer, that any person excludes only four persons. Those who have immunity. That's the president, the vice president, governor, or deputy governor, because they have immunity against criminal prosecution. No other person cannot be summoned before a parliament to answer when there's any allegation. As a matter of fact, the power is also given to not to parliament. Some disciplinary powers or sanctions are given to parliament for any infraction of this. I don't have the time not to go there. So my advice is, please and please. That's why I started on the note that we are not enemies, we are not friends. We respect you. You're working not for Nigeria, just like we're working not for Nigeria. But we are not saying we have even come to any conclusion. And I'm advising myself and my colleagues that is part of any provocation. We will not be provoked. We will give fair hearing to anyone. We have not said just because he brought a petition, therefore we have believed everything he knows that he said, because we have not seen our report. It is to enable us to make a just decision that we are saying, let us also hear from you. And that's why we are saying, make available to us some documents, including those documents that you said prompted the police to suspend him. The court orders that they are saying, there are court orders in respect of the matter, let us have them so that we may well decide whether to proceed or not to proceed, but it's not when you come and appear not before us. So please, we have had other agencies. I've been a member of a committee here which investigated the DSS. The DG of the DSS himself came and told us that he read out many matters that are in various courts. The only thing he said was, let me plead, in view of the sensitivity of the matter, please, let us not do the hearing in public. We obliged him, but we still listened to him, and he addressed all the issues, irrespective of the fact that they were in court. And honestly, you would get more respect from Parliament if you adopt that kind of approach. But if you adopt the approach that, no, you are the interpreter of the law, because if you listen to some of the words that have been used in your letter, they're embarrassing. They have been using words like sacrosanct. It's only the court of law that can use that kind of language. So please, I am pleading at this stage, Mr. Chairman, that we may not, let's say, give a final ruling, not today, in view of the fact that we have said, bring some documents to us. The chairman of the Service Commission has told us that he will make available those documents. I want to believe that even you too and the IG will make available those documents, and he too will come. It is if at the next adjourned date, here I am pleading, if at the next adjourned date, you do not come, you do not make available those documents, that will now look properly at Section 89 of the Constitution, and therefore decide whether to begin to use the powers given to us too by the Constitution. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That is quite understandable, but to use some of the terms that I used in that letter, like somebody alluded, I don't think this letter came from the IG. And if this is the IG's position, we will plead that and implore that he comes here and tell us, Parliament, that this is actually what his position is, that he is not prepared to appear, and also state the reasons that are contained in this letter for his non-appearance. Then we'll take it a step further and give him reasons and Nigerians why he needs to appear. Like Patrick said, so many other prominent citizens have been invited here. And without being modest, the president appears here to present a budget. So I don't see anybody in this country that is too big to appear before Parliament if the president himself can come here to present his budget. And other security heads also come here almost on a daily basis to make an appearance. The former IG who is seated here will allude to the fact that when he was IG, he made appearances before this noble parliament. So if the IG needs time, he should make a special request and appeal to the parliament to give him a date on which he wishes to be present. I think this is about the third time that we're getting the same excuse over and over. I want to concede, like the previous speaker, that we give him another opportunity. But let him communicate to this assembly when he will be available so that this matter can be put to rest, because we don't want to go the whole hog without listening to him. I so move.
I quite agree with you. I quite agree with you in all your submissions, and I want to place it on record that I in no time berated the IG. Rather, I have fettered the IG, and this committee has fettered him to a point
that some persons will even feel, ah, is the IG above the law? Since we started this hearing, the IG has not appeared before this committee. This was the first letter he sent explaining his absence. On the first day, we sat. And he sent the commissioner of police in question, who has now turned to be a letter writer. And we obliged the commissioner of police, knowing the esteemed office of the inspector general. We took him. They brought their submissions. Then the second hearing, still the IG was not there. Neither was there any letter from the IG. The same inspector, the same commissioner of police appeared. And the committee queried to find out why the IG was not here. Was he above the law? Was he above parliament? And those were some of the side comments a legislator will always make. And nobody wanted to bring down the office or the person or berate the office of the IG. And what I said was subject to his own submission that the IG, at that point where Benue and other places were burning, was on leave. And it was by the side. I said, at this time, when we have very serious national security issues, and that was not intended to berate the IG. Even when one of my colleagues made reference to a former IG that was investigated, it was not to bring him down. The legislature has its own way of working. We cannot work like the police and vice versa. And so nobody can teach us how and where and when to do our work. As I've said earlier, we are complete here. Intellectually, professionally, we are very complete in Parliament. And so I want to adopt what my colleague and learned friend Puayok and Sunday have said. We cannot, because of this letter, now go into combat with the IG. No. We will not do that. We want to appeal to the IG. It is the police that says the police are your friends. So the parliament, we are the friends of the IG and the police. We are not your enemies at all. We will not want to, if we wanted to bring down from day one, we would have brought in cameras. But we did not. We were actually seeking for a way for these people to settle, for DCP Lafia and the IG. Because these are weighty issues of corruption, harassment, and threat to life. My honorable colleagues, the chairman, our respected elder, the press, after going through the submissions of both the complainant and the IG, and then the court processes, and we subjected them to our own legal processes here in Parliament. It is clear even from the submissions just today that the issues canvassed in court are different from the issues to be determined before Parliament. And so it is based on that this committee has resolved to continue with this investigative hearing. And therefore, we will appeal to all the parties to appear before this committee for purposes of fair hearing, so that we can have their own sides and do our reports expected by Parliament. As I said earlier, let me reiterate, nobody outside Parliament can teach Parliament how to go about their duties. We know how to go about our duties. We know when to go about our duties. And so, we will give another date for purposes of fair hearing for the IG of police to appear before this committee. As it is according to Section 88, which they quoted in their letter, and Section 89 of the Nigerian Constitution 1979 as amended, to appear this committee and prove his innocence on the contents of the motion before Parliament. Honorable colleagues, it is on this note that I now ask the question on the motion by Honorable Sunday Katung. Let me first of all ask if there is a seconder to Honorable Sunday Katung's motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Honorable Prestigious Member representing Abanot Basa Federal Constituency. I hereby second the motion, ably moved by my colleague, Honorable Sunday Katung. I so second, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The motion has been moved and seconded. So I put the question. All those in favor of the motion, say aye. Those against it, say nay. The ayes have it. Okay. Honorable colleagues, what is our next date of sitting? We are aware that we are also going for Easter break. Should we take it after Easter break?
Yes.
Okay. All right, before we adopt the adjournment, please, our elder and former IG, chairman of the police commission, you remember we requested some records from you. We will also not do anything that, in the speaker's opinion, will prejudice what is in the courts. But if in the speaker's opinion, as it is now, that we go into the issues before us, we will continue. So please be reminded of all the relevant documents that we have requested. You can liaise with the clerk, and then they will be submitted to the secretariat. Motion for adjournment.